GPS systems such as Texas Instruments' TI-4100 NAVSTAR Navigator have revolutionized the geosciences. The systems and the UNAVCO consortium that provided training, support, instruments, and data management help to study natural hazards such as earthquakes and volcanic deformation, advance our nascent understanding of plate tectonics, set up the first monuments and baselines, test the accuracy of the new GPS technology, develop the software, tools, and logistics for GPS campaigns and networks.
The theory of plate tectonics, when I think of what this instrument did in contributing to establishing that theory, it's just incredible. I've never been so close to something that's been so important in terms of changing the way people think about the world.
In 1984, the U.S. National Science Foundation supported the University NAVSTAR Consortium, UNAVCO, to expand geoscience research through shared GPS resources, and so began a revolution in geodesy.
And the receiver was an expensive piece of equipment, very few of them initially. So those few TI-4100s, I was proud to be someone who was able to help the scientists use those effectively.
Texas Instruments sold commercial TI-4100 NAVSTAR Navigator systems from 1982 to 1989. NAVSTAR is short for Navigation, Satellite, Timing, and Ranging. UNAVCO purchased three of these commercial units, known affectionately as UN-01, UN-02, and UN-03. UNAVCO was among the first to use commercial receivers for early benchmarking, surveying, and precise positioning for research.
The first GPS instrument was the TI-4100, and today we use different instruments, but it's all, the roots are of all the work we do basically started with the TI-4100.
I got my start as a graduate student working in California. We used the TI-4100 instruments, some of the earliest civilian GPS receivers, to measure the deformation associated with the San Andreas Fault in California.
We did the first pioneering GPS surveys, you know, in a major tectonic environment, and the first one, of course, in an active volcano.
Each TI-4100 system and its post-processing software was about $165,000, beyond what an individual researcher could afford. So the UNAVCO consortium supported shared instruments, training, and data analysis.
In the old days, graduate students were sent out to babysit the instruments because the instrument was worth more than we were paid for 5 years of thesis.
Each TI-4100 system consisted of two white steel boxes of about 80 pounds each. One box contained the receiver processor assembly with a control display unit.
You had to punch in all of the numbers. You had to punch in the satellite scenarios so that the instrument knew where to look in the sky for the satellites at the time. Now it's all done. It's all done automatically because there are so many satellites, but in the beginning the instrument didn't know what part of the sky it should be looking in, and so we had to tell it, give it a couple of places to start looking at, to start making its search.
And the other box contained the recorder assembly and an antenna with a pre-amplifier. The program to control the receiver was stored on a cassette tape and had to be loaded each time it was turned on.
Out of the box, the equipment has no brains. It's no operating system or anything. So you would load in the operating system through tapes, you know, these little cassette tapes, and they would run for about half an hour or more. You'd finally have everything right. Then you'd ready for the survey. Then you'd pull out those tapes, put in the data tapes, and start the survey. And if anything went awry, and it sometimes did, then you had to start that whole process over. Meanwhile, the clock is ticking. You've lost that, you're starting to lose that 4 hour window of satellite availability, so.
It took two 40 pound batteries to power the instrument for the duration of the typical 4 to 8 hour observing window.
It would run on two car batteries for about 5 hours. So unlike now, our systems will run for months on two car batteries. That was, you had to have batteries all charged, ready to go.
I mentioned that we had to do this in California at night, because that was the only time the satellites were overhead. It was before the collection of GPS satellites called the Constellation was complete. So time, tide, and satellite wait for no man. And damn few women.
The survey we did in Hawaii on Maui, that was the first time that GPS had been to those sites, so we were actually putting in the markers that other people would use in the future. And techniques, geodetic techniques like satellite laser ranging and VLBI had been around for a lot longer. And so that experiment was about tying in this new GPS technique to the reference frames that had been developed by the techniques of SLR and VLBI.
Well, the benefit was they gave reliable data. It was really the first field transportable system. So truly, we could pack them up on our backs. All these batteries are on horses, and of course everybody in the world wanted to know what we were doing, because we did them along the side of roads where there were existing benchmarks. And we would have hundreds of people stop and see us. They thought we were part of the Park Service interpretation divisions. And then when we told them what we were doing, they'd say, I don't see the satellites up there.
The reason that we wanted to use this receiver in the Southwest Pacific is because the scientists I was supporting their research, they wanted to make the first direct measurements of how plate tectonics were moving. So we went to all of these different islands so we could measure how the plates were moving in that part of the world.
The biggest benefit was just learning how to do surveying. The fact is, how to run GPS campaigns, how to work internationally, how to develop international collaborations and do the logistics in these different places where we wound up, you know, really doing some work over the next 20 years. We trained students from Hacettepe University. Our principal collaborator was a professor there, and he invited us to do the first GPS survey in Turkey.
It's telling us now about ice mass loss. It has been an evolution from those very, very early days when we only had three instruments. In Greenland, we have more than 65 instruments observing today. So the technology has come a long way, and it's touching science from atmospheric science, environmental science, climate change science, as well as all of the solid earth sciences.
UNAVCO's TI-4100s have been around the world in support of geoscience research.
This interview before?
No.
Am I the first?
You'll be the
first. Oh my gosh! I'm Tonie Van Dam. I'm a professor at the University of Luxembourg.
My name is Robert Reilinger. I'm a principal research scientist at MIT.
My name is Barbara Perrin, and I work at the University of Colorado Boulder.
My name is Kurt Feigl. I'm a professor at the University of Wisconsin Madison.
Chuck Meertens, Charles Meertens. Director of the Geodetic Data Services at UNAVCO.
Well, my name is Robert B. Smith, otherwise known as Bob Smith. I am a professor of geophysics at the University of Utah in Salt Lake City.